the meeting is now streaming live on YouTube.
So, yes, we are live. We can go ahead.
Can I start, Dr. Ishu?
Yes, sir. You can start, Dr. Rao.
So, good evening, everyone. In this series of another webinar, I welcome you all on behalf of Rajasthan Orthopedic Surgeons Association. First of all, I would like to invite our President, Dr. Rajesh Goyal, sir, for his opening address. Rajesh Goyal, sir, over to you. Sir, Rajesh Goyal, sir.
Yeah. Good evening, dear friends. On behalf of ROSA, I welcome you all. This is the 10th webinar which we are hosting, and it's a special webinar on arthroscopy. We have with us three national faculty, Dr. Sachin Tapaswi. We are loving him because he is providing fellowship to our members to his clinic. Then Dr. Raju Eswaran from Delhi, Dr. Rajiv Raman, very loving friend of mine from Calcutta. Then we have our state faculties, Dr. Ashish, Dr. Saurav Mathur, Dr. Vikram Sharma, Dr. Rajat Jangid, Dr. Sumit Banerjee, Dr. Mahendra Budania, Dr. Rajendra Setia. These are the all faculties. I am sure that you will be able to solve queries in arthroscopy. Thank you very much. And now I hand over this to Dr. Ashish. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rajesh. And let's not waste time. Let's start with Dr. Sachin's lecture. So we just eagerly, everyone is waiting for his lecture on multi-ligament injuries of knee. Over to Sachin.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. And thank you, dear friends. Thank you, President, sir. And thank you, Secretary, sir, of ROSA. Dear friends, Ashish Sharma, whom I spent a very nice time with when we were doing our fellowship together in Australia, in Adelaide. I think these are the testing times where I think these memories which you have gathered and created over years probably keep you going. And these are the fond memories that really are very close to all of us. Also, a big thank you to Saurav Mathur, who initially was working with me as a fellow. But I think now I have a lot to learn from him, as he has scaled great heights in this field of arthroscopy, both knee and shoulder. And it's really nice when we see that, you know, someone whom you have tried to nurture has gone five steps ahead of you and is doing really fantastic work. Rajasthan is probably like a second home for me. I have a lot of fond memories of this place, and I would definitely want to keep coming back to the same place over and over again. Today, I have been asked to speak and give an introductory talk or an overview on multi-ligament knee injuries. And I think in this, we'll look at four different aspects of multi-ligament knee injuries, which we'd like to sort of share here. What's important to understand is that when you have a knee dislocation, it usually implies that, you know, you have disruption of both cruciates with either or both corners. So what this means is that when you essentially talk about a multi-ligament injured knee, you probably have a knee that has been dislocated at the time of the injury, but has got spontaneously relocated as well. Multi-ligament knee dislocation, thereby I can very safely say that would imply that this particular individual has had an episode of a knee dislocation. And though you may not sort of view the knee as a dislocated knee when he presents to you at the same time. Also, what is very important to understand that you may also have a multi-ligament knee dislocation, multi-ligament knee injury without the presence of a knee dislocation. And these two entities can be very much confused at the same time. The usual etiology that probably all of us are aware of is going to be all the high energy trauma per se. But I think what is more important to understand that more and more we see patients who've got very low or ultra low energy trauma. And essentially, if you see the super obese patients, they can have a very simple type of an injury, such as, you know, a misstep during walking, and they'll end up with a grossly dislocated knee and multi-ligament knee disruption, which may then lead to diagnostic problems. And these may have a very high incidence of injuries to the neurovascular structure. So morbid obesity, I think please keep in mind, these patients who are ultra morbid, they may have, you know, a very high incidence of getting multi-ligament knee injuries. And many a times, because of that huge size of that leg, the injury may then be missed. And mind you, most often than not, these patients have a very high incidence of neurovascular complications. So this is a 43-year-old male who had a 4-ligament knee injury. So he was a KD4, and this presented following a motor vehicle accident. These were his x-rays when he presented about 4 days following the injury. And these were his MRI scans. So as you walk through these MRI scans from your top left to your bottom right, on the top left, you can observe that he's got a torn ACL. The image to the next of that shows that he's got a torn lateral side. The coronal section, which is third on your bar top, shows that he's got an MCL as well as bone bruises on the lateral side. And so on and so forth, you can very clearly and nicely see that he's got a 4-ligament rupture. This was his clinical exam at day 4, mind you. You can see that he's got a pretty stable knee in this particular aspect. And when we braced him and we asked him to walk, this is how he was mobilizing. To my great surprise, one can also observe here that his knee was slowly settling when he started to ease down. And we did want to wait for a couple of days because we felt that the bone bruises were not that great. So I think the take-home message was that this patient taught me that not all multi-ligament knee injuries that show up on MRI scans require surgery. And a small proportion of them, about 10 to 15%, do become stable by themselves. So it's important that you choose discretion. Whenever you see someone who has come in with a multi-ligament knee injury, if you see that, you know, they have got far better function than what their MRI scan should suggest, and or their MRI scan shows very less amount of bone bruise patterns, then you can choose to treat them non-surgically with appropriate bracing and splinting, and this forms a good way of treating them. Let's look at another example. This is a 32-year-old policeman with a 1-week-old injury. He has a grade 2 MCL, as you can see here. He also has a grade 3 PCL and ACL on his clinical examination. And again, his neurovascular is intact. So for this patient, we really discussed a lot of options, whether we should do a single stage procedure, whether we should do a 2-stage procedure, what should we reconstruct in the first stage, what should we reconstruct in the second phase, or should we just cast him, splint him, or what should we essentially do? So in this particular patient, since he had a relatively good muscle tone, good compliance, we chose to go ahead and do what is called as a primary open repair of all his ligaments. So here we are suturing and putting back his ACL in his place. So we start off by looking at all the injuries that he's got. This is his PCL. We've prepared his PCL with the help of strong sutures, since they were predominantly avulsions from the femoral side. So your MRI scan picture did show that the injury that he had of his cruciates was not of an avulsion type. So we chose to treat him with primary repair of both his PCL and his ACL in this particular manner, and then went on to repair his capsule and then added MCL repair along with an MCL internal brace. So many a times what you can do is that nature creates the arthrotomy by you by producing a capsular tear. You can just extend that capsular tear, and on your way out, you can repair it. Of course, these patients require a very highly skilled rehab, which needs to be supervised. You need to ensure that you start moving them in a phase-wise manner. You start getting them to weight bear in a phase-wise manner, and then you progress. But the caveat here is that you need excellent physical therapy with very good pain relief. And as what was expected, he did have post-operative stiffness. And this was how his knee was at the end of 5 weeks following the surgical treatment. He was barely getting from full extension to about 45 degrees of knee flexion. And one had to do for him an arthroscopic release at the end of 5 to 6 weeks to get back his full range of motion. We chose specifically to do an arthroscopic release because it was important not to cause any inadvertent force, and that also allowed us to examine his insertional sites that had healed completely well. He then went on to make a very good progress. So primary repair is the second option in which you can treat these multi-ligament knee injuries. You have to select the ideal candidate. He has to be compliant. And the major disadvantage is that if you have avulsions of the cruciates, then you can really institute this technique. It avoids any form of graft harvest. And I think this provides us the best biology. The third scenario in which you would encounter in multi-ligament knee injuries is presented here. This is a 32-year-old lady. She's got a one-day-old injury and presents with a grade 3 MCL. You can see that in full extension as well as in 30 degrees of knee flexion, her whole knee opens out and she's got a grade 3 ACL and a PCL. So this is a one-day-old trauma with major disruption of the tissues. Her MR scan shows that the whole MCL is predominantly tibial-sided. Additionally, what is important here is that you can see that she's got very large bruises on her lateral femoral condyle and her lateral tibial condyle as well. And stress X-ray show the presence of somewhat of a rim lesion in which you have a small avulsion flake that comes off. So these are the patients that are best treated in a two-stage procedure. So a medial-sided exposure on stage one, you go down, you first repair layer 3, which is essentially the meniscotibial ligaments with the help of suture anchors. Once you've repaired layer 3, you then go to layer 2, you close layer 2, which is the superficial MCL. And after having done that, you do give them an ACL augmentation with the help of a soft tissue graft. After that, she was then braced, mobilized later on. And after she attained complete movement and mobility, she then went on to have a delayed ACL-PCL reconstruction with the help of a quad tendon graft for her PCL and a contralateral hamstrings graft for her ACL. So this is how typically one would manage most of multi-ligament injuries that come to us. We typically sort of do them as a two-stage procedure, and this would probably be the most common modality of managing multi-ligament knee injuries. You treat the collateral or the cruciate in the first sitting, and then you come back to do the other collateral or the other corner at a second stage. So various ways of treating these type of injuries, which is what is completely important. I am not going into the individual techniques for reconstructing the various grafts, because we do have some really fantastic cases that are coming up for all of us by the next couple of speakers. I'll come to the last case scenario, or the last way these multi-ligament knee injuries present. This is a 31-year-old male who had a KD5. He had an ACL, PCL, along with an MCL and a tibial plateau fracture, more of an osteochondral fragment as you see here. This was initially managed at his place somewhere in Madhya Pradesh with the help of these two cross K wires, and he was left alone. When I saw him, he was almost about close to 4 or 5 years following the injury, and he presented with a valgus knee with a splayed out lateral tibial plateau with a persistently posteriorly subluxed tibia. So this meant that he had a PCL injury which caused posterior subluxation. He had a knee that was drifting into valgus, partly because of the osteochondral fragment, partly because of the MCL. And this was what his imaging showed, which showed the presence of plateau depression. And we then went on to treat him. First thing that you need to do is to gain movement. So we did an arthroscopy for him. We ensured that we looked at his cartilage. He was young. This does show osteoarthritic changes, but functionally he wasn't that too bad. So we didn't decide to do any form of arthroplasty for him, but he did have a deficient MCL, ACL and PCL. As you can see here, that's his medial compartment, completely large drive-through sign here, gross medial laxity. So there was definitely a very high pressing sort of reason for us to do some sort of good reconstructive procedure and completely deficient ACL and PCL. On the lateral side, we had complete sort of sequestration of his cartilage on the posterolateral aspect of the tibia. As when we bring his leg into a figure of four, this is probably the fragment that had been not so adequately fixed with the help of K-wires. And this is what his posterolateral aspect of the tibia was looking like. Being a policeman, he was very keen to go back to his same activities of living. And he did have a lot of demand on his knee. So we just did an arthroscopic release as stage one and curated out the cartilage. We then called him back for a stage two procedure in which we corrected his valgus with the help of a distal femoral osteotomy. It was a lateral opening wedge, and we supplemented that with a same stage PCL reconstruction, which was done with the help of his ipsilateral peroneus longus. We also did a simultaneous medial collateral ligament reconstruction with the help of his ipsilateral hamstrings, as what has been shown in these x-rays here. So this will form the fourth method of patients presenting with an multi-ligament knee injuries. They present in a delayed fashion with a neglected MLKI. And when you tackle these, you need to think about alignment first. If the alignment is normal, then you can go ahead and do the collaterals and the cruciates. But if the alignment is abnormal, you need to do correction both in the sagittal and the coronal plane. Once you've evaluated the abnormal alignment, you then do a realignment surgery as phase one, and then go ahead and do the reconstruction as phase two. So to conclude, I think it's important that we need to treat these multi-ligament knee injuries aggressively, because they have a very high risk of getting stiffness. They have a very high risk of landing up with late neuropraxia and disabling arthritis with loss of function. And I think it becomes very important upon us to recognize these particular injuries very early, categorize your patient into the four subgroups that we've spoken of, and then you have to pick which is going to be the winner treatment for your particular patient and help him with the same. Thank you so very much, dear friends, for allowing me to bring in the introductory talk for today's session, and hand it over to Ashish Sharma and Saurabh Mathur to continue the proceedings. Thank you very much. I think Ashish, you need to unmute, please. Ashish, you need to unmute. Yeah.
Thank you, Sachin. Thank you for the wonderful, wonderful talk. Always, it's a pleasure to listen to your talks. Next up, can we start with Raju? Raju, you have your cases lined up, a couple of them.
I certainly do. First of all, I'd like to thank the Rajasthan Orthopedic Society for having me present the cases. Rajasthan and Tamil Nadu are the two favorite states of mine whenever I travel. And the common denominator is the love for facial hair. And I really love Rajasthan in more ways than one. So I'll start my cases. Just give me a second. So are you able to see my screen?
Yes, we do. We can see.
So I'll present two cases of medial instability in a multi-ligament scenario. One of them is in sync with what Dr. Sachin spoke about, the obese persons who can have low velocity injuries. And the other one also he hinted, the tibial injuries of the MCL. So this is a scenario which is very interesting to look. So this is a 17-year-old boy. He was riding pillion with his father in a scooty. He fell down and he presented to me on the second day. The clinical findings are shown. He had valgus laxity at 30 degrees and a positive Lachman. Now, I'd just like to ask the opinion of the panel. The x-rays were under, I'll share the x-rays as well, but I'd just like the opinion of the panel on the MRI. This is the coronal MRI scene, and I'll just take you through the relevant sections. So this particular section shows a ACL bony avulsion. And I'd just like to draw the attention to this particular portion of the coronal image, which can be seen in further detail in subsequent sections. And I'll just pause the slide here and just take the collective opinion of the panel as to what you think the personality of the soft tissue injury is.
Yeah, so Rajat is here. Rajat, you want to comment? Is Rajat not here? So can we have Rajiv? Rajiv, luckily the cyclone is a little away.
Rajat is also there.
Hello. Yes, sir. Yeah, so I was mutated by Dr. Rahul. So there is a medial sided soft tissue contusion. There is a bony contusion on the medial femoral condyle. And there is a tibial sided avulsion from the MCL. So these are this medial sided soft tissue injury.
Correct. Okay. So again, the reason why I brought this out is that ACL plus MCL is the commonest multi-ligament injury. I mean, a double ligament injury apart from a isolated injury of the ACL. ACL, PCL isn't that common a combination. The commonest multi-ligament injury happens to be ACL and MCL. And in this particular instance, it is the MCL is a victim of a lot of misplaced optimism because we generally feel that MCL injuries heal with conservative treatment. But this is a very special variety of MCL injuries, and I'd like to have the panel's opinion throw more light on this injury for our colleagues. Rajiv, what are your thoughts on an injury of this type?
Yeah, it's almost complete avulsion from the tibial side. So it's a complete rupture. It's almost grade 3 injury, Raju.
Yeah. And again, there's also, if you see here, a little bit of disruption of the deep MCL as well, the meniscofemoral component.
Ligament.
It's accompanied by a little bit of bony flake, as Dr. Rajat very accurately pointed out. So again, the personality of this injury is this, an ACL bony avulsion from the tibia, a superficial MCL injury from the tibia, and maybe a deep MCL from the femur. I'd like the panel's opinion on how best they would like to treat this patient if they were to come to him.
So, Sumit, you want to take up? Unmute yourself.
Yeah. Hi. Thank you very much. So, essentially, the first things first is, if it's an acute injury, I would like to first thing look out for is the neurovascular injury.
It's an acute injury and it's normal. Neurovascular is absolutely normal.
Absolutely normal. All right. Great. Great. Then since it's an ACL avulsion alongside a tibial avulsion of the MCL as well,
yeah.
So for the superficial one, I would like to go in and fix it.
Okay, so you would be inclined to operate the MCL.
Yeah. Depending on if it's within the first 3 weeks. If it's in the first 3 weeks.
This patient has come to you on the second day of injury.
Second day of it. All right, so then I would like to wait. At this point, I would like to wait for a couple of weeks for it to settle down. And then I would reassess. And if the, let's say the medial stress test, if it is 3 or plus positive, then yes, I would like to fix it.
Right. So since this is an acute injury, you would probably like to take the middle path. You'd probably like to wait for a while and then reassess, and depending on what his clinical picture is.
Yeah.
Right. Any differing view in the panel, Dr. Ashish, can I probably ask you or how your approach would be in this?
So instance? Yeah, since it is an ACL avulsion, as such, I would like to fix an ACL avulsion almost always. So, and I would take the same opportunity to also, why not fix the MCL? So I would fix both in the first go.
Right. So I'll just twist the question a bit. If the ACL avulsion wasn't there, if it was a ligamentous ACL injury, would you have agreed with the earlier approach?
So then it depends if it is, what is the grade of MCL? So if it is grade 1 or 2, grade 1, almost always conservative first. Grade 2, I would like to see what are the other co-associated injuries. If there is any fracture associated, if there is any other ligament, I would also fix, tackle that ligament along with MCL. But if it is grade 3, definitely, yes, I would.
So your decision would be based on the clinical grade of the MCL injury.
Exactly.
Regardless
exactly.
of whether it is from the tibia or from the femur.
Exactly.
Any other differing opinions in the panel? Can I ask Dr. Sachin on what he would like to do with this patient?
So I think, Raju, the discussion that we've heard here is absolutely completely in sync with what I feel. I would really love to see what... There are two things here. There is an ACL injury, there is an MCL injury. Treatment for the ACL injury would be imaging-based for me. If it is, because it's an avulsion, if it is it a type 2 or a type 3? If so, I would like to see the lateral or the sagittal sections. If it is a type 2 or a type 3, my treatment plan for the ACL avulsion is going to be surgical. My treatment plan for the MCL is going to be a clinical-based decision, unlike the ACL, which is going to be an imaging-based decision. If there is grade 3 opening, both in full extension and 30 degrees of flexion, then I would be more inclined towards surgical treatment for the MCL. If not, I'll be more than happy to do a non-surgical treatment for the MCL.
Correct.
Sachin sir,
yes, please.
Does it make a difference that if the MCL tear is from a tibial side or a femoral side? Because from the, when it is avulsed from the tibial side, usually we see that it comes above the pest, and conservative treatment usually don't work. So does your decision vary to see whether it is from a tibial side or a femoral side?
Yes, thank you, Saurabh. You've made a very good point there. Tibial-sided lesions in general are known to be a bit more notorious, but I think not all tibial-sided lesions are notorious. So in that, what you really need to see is whether you have a Stenner's lesion. If you see a Stenner lesion where, you know, the interrelationship of the PES and the MCL have been disrupted, then there is no question. You have to go ahead and do it. But what you see here, which Raju has very nicely shown in his particular imaging here, where there is no Stenner's lesion, then in these patients, you may go ahead and do non-surgical treatment of them. And especially since this is an immature sort of skeleton with a very high propensity for healing, I may err towards non-surgical treatment only if I find that it is not opening grade 3 in full extension and at about 30 to 60 degrees of flexion.
Correct. So maybe the images were not projecting very accurately, but then again, I'm not a great expert at MRI interpretation, but whenever I see rolled up ligament on the medial side, I almost always assume that it is a Stenner lesion, because an MRI can suffer from multiple variables, lack of clarity in reporting, lack of clarity in images. So this particular section in which it is seen as a rolled up thing, that somehow tells me that the MCL has gone off from the tibia. It has slipped superficial to the pes anserinus and rolled itself into a ball. And this is one variety of MCL that I would probably encourage colleagues to consider an early surgery on, regardless of the grade of instability. And the same rolling up can be very easily observed after you give the incision. And I'll just end up with what I did in this particular case. So as you can clearly see, the MCL is actually flipped superficial to the pes anserinus, and generally it's not going to heal on its own unless you are able to reposition it back to its correct anatomic plane. The rest is a simple exercise in anatomy, and these leading sutures that you see, since you've already gone ahead and operated, fix the ACL avulsion as well. So you can clearly see that it has flipped superficial to the pes anserinus. Fixation is accomplished at the usual insertion point, which is roughly 6 centimeters below the medial joint line. A combination fixation was chosen here, a metallic suture anchor in combination with a screw and a post. And the other fixation device that you see is a fixation. It's a simple button that we use to fix for ACL avulsion. So the ACL avulsion was also fixed. I'll probably skip the technique of ACL avulsion because it is beyond the scope of discussion. And move on to my second case, which is a bit more severe in spectrum compared to this. So again, the message that I would like to give from this first case is that clinical assessment of MCL is of paramount importance, particularly in femoral injuries. But if it's a tibial injury, a close inspection of the MRI, and if it shows a rolled up MCL like a ball, it may be a better idea to go ahead with the early surgery and fix the tibial site.
So Raju, can I ask you one thing?
Yeah.
So if it is MCL grade 3 along with ACL, so do you do reconstruction if you repair the MCL, do you do reconstruction the same sitting, or do you advise delaying the ACL?
A bit of both. So it again depends on the patient profile. Like in Dr. Sachin's talk, he showed two policemen with multi-ligament injuries. A person of that profile will probably need everything to be addressed in one go because of multiple activity levels and practical considerations. In this particular case, you will see that sometimes you don't need to do everything all at one go. You can stage it in a convenient manner.
Fair enough.
Right. So this is another spectrum of medial-sided injury. So this is a 35-year-old lady She is slightly heavy. I think the BMI hovered somewhere around 30. And all she did was she fell off her scooty. And I don't have the whole series of x-rays, but then she probably had a knee dislocation. And while these knees may look clinically very innocuous, the very fact that the knee is non-concentrically reduced is an alarming indicator. So I would just like the opinion of the panel on this particular x-ray and the clinical picture. What all do you think is amiss in this particular x-ray?
So Mahinder, you want to take up? Mahinder, you have to unmute yourself. Unmute yourself, please. You need to unmute. Yeah,
sir, am I audible?
Yeah, we can hear you now.
Yeah. Sir, probably this is the case of knee dislocation. So in first instance, once such kind of patient comes in emergency, we should always think about the distal neurovascularity of the limb.
Okay, so I can tell you that the neurovascular status is okay, and it's a very valid point made by the previous panelist as well.
And this x-ray shows that this knee is still in subluxated position. So my first concern is to realign the tibia and femur. So first of all, I have to reduce the knee joint in proper alignment.
Correct. So would you do that in your clinic under local anesthesia or maybe some sedation, or would you like to take the patient formally to the
hospital? I think this knee is not completely dislocated. It's a subluxated knee, so it may be possible. It may be possible to get it reduced. But if it is better if you will reduce it under image intensifier guidance, and you are not able to reduce it properly in that situation, I have to give him or her some sedation or an anesthesia also.
Correct. So again, I don't unfortunately have the relevant MRI images to show you. I managed to lose them. But then since this lady came to me from outside Delhi, I think it was Moradabad, on the second day after the injury, and since this was the condition of the knee, I decided to get an MRI done. And as is usually the case, an MRI shows almost everything to be torn. So the MRI report came out to be an ACL injury, a PCL injury, and a MCL injury. Now, knowing the MRI report, would you still like to go ahead with the line of management that you suggested, or would you like to expand on your answer and think of a further line of management? Do you like to still reduce under anesthesia, or would you plan something definitive for this?
So if both collateral ligaments gone, and you are saying that both cruciate gone.
Yeah, both cruciates and one collateral, medial collateral and ACL and PCL.
And you got the MRI, good quality MRI at the same time.
Yeah.
And you are not able to reduce the knee joint.
Yeah, I mean, this is the X-ray, which is there in front of you. So it's non-concentric reduction with all these soft tissue injuries.
So it is, so definitely it is possible to have some soft tissue entrapment in the joint. So it is that mandatory to open the knee joint at the same time. So it is the case for emergency service.
Right. So I'll share one more clinical picture with you. So this is the amount of valgus laxity with the knee in full extension, and nearly a similar amount of valgus laxity exists with the knee in 30 degrees of flexion. I'll take you through a examination video. So do you see hyperextension?
Hyperextension.
You see a positive posterior drawer, and of course an anterior drawer as well. These are instances where you can't do the classical ACL test like pivot shift, etc., because they will not be positive. But what is seen as the massive amount of, it's called a open door or a swinging door kind of a valgus instability, both at full extension and at 30 degrees of knee flexion. So my question to the panel, what all structures do you think are injured in this particular person? Do you rely more on your clinical examination, or do you rely more on an examination under anesthesia to formulate your surgical treatment plan?
So Saurabh, you want to take up? Saurabh?
Yeah.
So, see, it clearly says that all the medial...
Saurabh, can I request you to just keep your mic a little close to your face?
Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Now it's much better. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. So, see, looking at the clinical picture and the X-rays and the MR, what you told, it looks that it's a severe injury, like severe soft tissue injury on the medial side, and which has caused MCL plus posterior oblique ligament, maybe up to MPFL kind of, and along with capsule tear. So it needs to be addressed. Open repair has to be done, and it has to be a complete repair. Like we have to consider all the medial structure to be repaired. Then comes the ACL and PCL, which can be taken care of later on, or maybe in a single sitting. It all depends the edema and swelling and preoperative range of patient. Otherwise, medial structure has to be taken care
of. So if I can summarize your answer, you would be more inclined to repair the medial structures and handle the cruciates at a later stage. The medial structures you would like to repair, and you did mention that you think that the MCL, the POL, and maybe even the MPFL are injured, and you would probably like to address them depending on the clinical condition.
Maybe the capsule also, because the X-ray what you showed, sometimes in ID case, it is very common to see buttonholing of the femoral condyle.
Correct.
Which might cause, show that kind of picture, the X-ray picture might be like that. So the capsule might also have been injured.
Correct. So just like our trauma colleagues like to understand the personality of a fracture, and this is the personality of the soft tissue injury as accurately shown by Saurabh. Dr. Ashish, any further questions that you would like to ask the panel on the management, or do you want me to proceed?
Yeah, so this is the basic is that we need to get the collaterals right. So this is what just what Saurabh said. This is the same approach that I usually also prefer.
Okay.
We can deal with the ACL and PCL later. Any other opinion, Dr. Sachin?
The reason why I'm constantly asking this question, and I'd like to know Dr. Sachin's opinion, is what would he do for the PCL? Because a lot of people feel that PCL should always be reconstructed or repaired or whatever in the first stage.
Yeah.
So Raju, I have one question here actually. Why was the knee not reduced? Was it irreducible? Or was it just technical skill that was lacking? On the first X-ray that you had, why was the knee not reducible? I think you have got a very important point here. And I'd really like you to elaborate and discuss all the with all the attendees. What should come to your mind when your knee is not reduced?
Correct. So my feeling is that probably it was just like Saurabh also pointed out, it was probably an invagination of the medial complex into the femoral condyle that resulted in a non-concentric reduction. Maybe the limb was also not adequately splinted, and it was a trick of the projection when the X-ray was taken. But when she came to me, I didn't clinically feel any major impediments to reduction that I could see. Rajiv, you raised your hand. You want to say something in this particular case?
Yeah, actually, a meniscocapsular entrapment and with a bruise on the medial side, it's a telltale sign. So whenever you see a bruise on the medial side at the joint level with the opening of the medial joint space, it's an entrapment. I think it's a medical emergency, because if you leave this case for 1 or 2 days, there's a chance of skin necrosis also.
Correct.
And sometimes it's not possible to reduce it to close reduction. Most of the time you open and just you put your artery forceps of blood stone with a pop-up sound, it's reduced. Everything got reduced, and then you can repair it nicely.
Very true. And if time permits, I will just quickly share the image of a similar case. I'll just quickly move on with what I did in this particular instance. So again, this is the personality of the injury. So these are the clinical images. I'll just take them one by one. So on giving the medial incision, you see the entire medial soft tissues. They're totally gone concentrically from anterior to posterior, just like Saurabh had predicted. And this case was done a long time ago, and this was a very unique injury at that point in time. These days, we are doing it more routinely, a PCL femoral peel-off. Almost the entire PCL was intact, and it was just peeled off from the femur. So, management. Again, I throw this question to the panel. How would you think of managing the PCL, and what would you do for the medial sides? For the medial side, my specific question is, would you just be happy to repair or would you like to do an augmentation?
So, Rajinder, are you there? Rajinder, you want to unmute yourself? Yeah. So, Rajinder, your opinion, what would you like to do, repair or reconstruct?
I will repair the MCL and apply it because it is an open reductions and simultaneously I will do PCL reconstruction.
PCL reconstruction and MCL repair. Can I have Dr. Banerjee's views as well on this? Is he there?
Yeah. Thanks, Raju. I would again do a repair, but I would like to augment my repair.
By repair, you mean repair of the medial side?
The medial structures. The medial structures I would have to repair and augment. And PCL, I'm very tempted to, would be very tempted to repair it because everything is lying in front of me. But to be very honest, I have more often than not reconstructed it. So this, maybe.
So you would do a single stage PCL reconstruction and a medial sided repair. So I'm assuming
the first priority is medial side repair. That is there. After that, I'll see if, since the PCL is already lying there.
So Raju, I think it's already, everything is in front of us. PCL, we can assess whether it is repairable. If we can repair it, we repair it. Otherwise, we can even reconstruct it. Also, same for MCL. MCL, I would like to repair, but depends on the quality of MCL remaining. If it is completely shredded, then it has to be augmented. If it is repairable and the repair is good and the quality of MCL is good, then definitely I would not augment it. But if it looks a little skeptical whether it will hold, then I augment.
So I proceeded with the repair of the PCL. This was probably the first such ligament primary repair in my hands at that point in time. And as the clinical video later shows, the lady did remarkably well. Now, even though in these images, you can't assess the quality of tissue on the medial side, but then if I can just point out, or maybe even in this image, if you can see the medial epicondyle region, you see a lot of remnant here. So it's a shredded medial side. And that gives you an indicator that maybe you need to augment it as well. So I use the ipsilateral semi-T to do both the posterior oblique ligament and the superficial MCL augmentation. Of course, as Dr. Sachin told in his lecture, layer by layer repair, I mean, this is a wonderful exercise in anatomy. And as Dr. Banerjee also pointed out, if you want to do a PCL reconstruction, all you need to do is place your jig. The nature has done the dissection. You just need to do a open PCL reconstruction, which you can very easily do. I mean, you might struggle for graft options. That's a different thing. So that's how the reconstruction proceeded. Now, my question, I mean, despite everything, the patella was unstable. So I added an MPFL. I took the gracilis and I also added an MPFL reconstruction. This is, at least in my hands, one of the very few single digit numbers of multi-ligament knee injuries in which I've had to do an MPFL reconstruction. I'd like to know the opinion of the panel. Have they faced similar need in their patients and do they agree with what was done?
Never.
I've never got to do an MPFL because maybe I didn't get a case, but definitely I would agree with you. If needed, I would definitely do a reconstruction of MPFL also.
Rajiv, your thoughts?
Yeah, so I think best way, the PCL is very vascular structure. You have prepared it, and MCL, I always go for biological augmentation. And if we get MPFL along with this, yes, it's better to repair, but I have not got such through such scenario. I think that was the best thing you have done it.
So that's the final look at the reconstruction. And sometimes in these complex surgeries, you're working at a spinal level and you might tend to forget. I mean, as ligament reconstruction surgeons, we like everything nice and tight, but then a well-done PUL reconstruction is actually very slack in flexion. It is only tense and full extension and something which must be kept in mind. And again, I like to brace them in a PCL specific brace, especially since the PCL was handled with a repair and not a reconstruction. And here's this lady at the end of, I think, 6 weeks. And she isn't keen on getting her ACL reconstructed, even though her knee is unstable. As you can see, she is a little bit on the heavier side of society. But then she's quite happy for the activities that she intends to do. This knee is strong and stable for her. So to answer your question, Dr. Ashish, at the very first question that you posed before I posed this case was, yeah, do you do everything in one go or one after the other? So this probably is a lesson that maybe we can do it in a staged manner. I mean, like Dr. Sachin also showed, we can even sometimes conserve these injuries, or at least we can operate them in a staged manner. And sometimes if you read the literature in the journals, they all seem to do everything at one go. Maybe such an aggressive approach may not be required for all our patients.
Yeah. And just like you said that nature has done all the dissection for us. So once you go in, I mean, you can start from deep inside, start from detail and then capsule, and then layer by layer, you can just complete the repair. So this is a very good case of nature doing the dissection for you.
And Rajesh, if you permit, I will just run through. I mean, I will not take too much time. I'll just run through these images because Dr. Sachin mentioned this particular case, and it is very important for colleagues to just open their eyes to this particular instance. So before I begin the discussion of this case, I'll just show you something a bit unusual. I mean, patients like these are an orthopedic surgeon's delight. I mean, as a two-three patients, so to kafi achi chalti hai practice. This guy fell down while doing some wild party some 2-3 years ago. And he had a huge glass piece inside his knee. Doesn't recall how it got inside the knee. And this was my, this was the case where I had removed the largest foreign body arthroscopically from the knee. Arthroscopically, you could even see all the lamellations of this glass. But anyway, so on the opposite side, he was just parking his Bullet at home. And the Bullet fell down on him and it landed directly on the knee, causing an injury of this kind. So again, what I wanted to point out was, I would have probably asked this as a panel question, but in the interest of saving time and other colleagues for presenting, this excessively wide gap on the medial side and the presence of this dimple should alert your mind to the fact that there is something going wrong here. And maybe it's a case of medial soft tissue entrapment. I'll just quickly take you through the clinical examination video. Now, if you see, as you give a valgus stress, so this particular boy only has a positive valgus stress in 30 degrees of flexion. You see this dimple actually deepening. And as is true with all suspected multi-ligament injuries, you must examine for ACL and PCL. I'll just advance this video a bit, and he has a positive posterior drawer as well. Yeah, so a positive posterior drawer. Anterior drawer was quite good. So this is a typical MRI image. Sadly, this MRI image was not reported the way it should be. I mean, the MRI clearly shows that all the medial soft tissue has gone inside, and this perhaps may be a reflection of our radiologist's lack of exposure to this kind of an injury. It was probably just reported as an MCL injury. Only when I clinically examined the patient did I discover this dimple and retrospective analysis of the MRI film. So again, I'll just take you through the intra-op images. You give an incision and the condyle is subcutaneous. And as Rajiv said, all that you need to do is put in an artery forceps and take out the entrapped mechanism. And once you've done that, you could probably choose to reconstruct the PCL in the same setting because the nature has done the dissection for you. I've done that. This is an open PCL reconstruction. So medial repair and an open PCL reconstruction. Thanks once again. I'll stop sharing my screen and eagerly look forward to other cases.
Thank you, Raju. Thank you so much. Wonderful cases. Saurabh, you want to take up the next two cases?
Yes. Hitesh is here. So right now we are taking multi-ligament with a medial side instability. So Hitesh will be taking his multi-ligament case. I think it's a case of ACL PCL with MCL. Right, Hitesh?
Yes, sir. Okay, can
you start sharing your screen, please?
Yes, boss.
So main questions in multi-ligament injuries in front of us are basically, when should be operated, whether it should be reconstructed or primary repair, and third, rehabilitation after the surgery.
Then, so main, there are three things which we have to see.
The timing of multi-ligament injury, surgery, intervention or conservative. Second thing is whether to reconstruct it or to repair it. So we have primary repair. Raju has shown us a primary repair and Hitesh will be showing us the reconstruction. Then we will take the questions on the reconstruction and maybe a small part on the rehabilitation. As Sachin sir has already told us, we need to have a aggressive rehabilitation after multi-ligament injury. Yes, Hitesh?
We can see your screen. We can see Rahul on the screen.
Yes.
Hitesh, open your PPT slides. I think there is some issue with his internet connection.
Hitesh, open your PPT.
Is it showing, sir? Yes, I'm opening my PPT. Is it showing?
No, we can't. We can't see Hitesh.
Can't see your PPT.
Just a moment. What is showing? Yes, Hitesh, is it there?
Yeah, we can see now.
Yeah.
Okay, sorry, sir.
Make it yes. Full screen.
Sorry for the delay, boss. Yes, I am presenting. This is a 40-year male, had a history of electric shock and fall from height. Patient had a severe burn all over the body, back and both the legs and hand. And the patient was treated by plastic surgeon for 6 months. And then I operated upon this patient after 6 months. So the condition after the 6 months, the condition was healed burn scars and range of movement was near full and painless and grade 3 valgus laxity on an ACL-PCL laxity on anterior drawer test. And MRI was showing complete ACL-PCL and MCL tear. I don't have a recent that time of X-ray and MRI. This is the clinical picture I can show you. This is the skin condition of the patient. This is the healed burn scar. So what should be the treatment protocol for such kind of patients? I would like opinion from the panel how we should proceed for such patients. Ashley sir.
So Hitesh, I think we need to first assess what is the instability, what are the ligaments that we need to address, what is the motion, what is the stiffness. So first we need to make a diagnosis and then make a plan. So what all do you have lined up? I didn't see the MRI findings and the clinical findings. Can you just repeat?
So sir, basically, yes, this is the video I am showing you. This is the intro video.
Yeah.
How much? This is a drawer test.
Yeah. Grade 3.
Grade 3 laxity on the, and this was the skin condition, sir.
Yeah.
And this is the drawer test.
How much
is the almost grade varus, 3 in both?
How much is the varus valgus?
And this is a, yes, this varus was okay. And this was the valgus stress. It was almost grade 3, sir.
Okay. So I would like to, you know, give him a collateral stability and range of motion first. Start with physiotherapy.
Get patient. Sorry to interrupt you, sir. The patient came after after the injury. After 6 months, the range of movement was good, and this was the clinical scenario after the 6 months of injury, sir.
So I would see he has a lot of burns all over, and I think I would not be too aggressive with doing multiple ligaments at the same time. I first would give him a collateral stability so that he's able to walk without support. So number one. Number two, he has definitely grade 3 and quite a lot of laxity ACL, PCL. So he also needs a collateral after the collateral reconstruction. Definitely it would be a reconstruction because it's already 6 months. So reconstruct the MCL and then see if you can do the ACL next stage. I would do the ACL, PCL next stage.
Rajat, yes, Rajat, how will you manage? Yes.
So in this case, you know, Dr. Hitesh, he's having a chronic case scenario with a multiligamentous injury, and he has been operated by plastic surgeon for the burns. So in this case, my first thing I would like to look for is whether the patient is having anything, the contracture-like thing on the knee, whether the range of movement are full or not. So first thing is to rehabilitate that knee, because since it's a chronic scenario. So first,
ROM
I would
good.
Like to get the range of motion. Since the RMS is good, the skin conditions are good, there's no contraction, then I would like to, you know, in a chronic scenario, I would like to go for the all the ligaments reconstruction in a single phase. So ACL, PCL, or he has pointed out the MCL. So I would like to go for single stage surgery.
Okay, yes, Hitesh, now you can proceed.
So is there any difference in the graft showing the three ligaments? What would be your graft choice for this patient? And since this patient was bedridden for 6 months, so what would be the difference for the ligament?
We are not able to hear you.
I think he's asking about the graft choices. What graft would you use for reconstruction?
So in my opinion, if the hamstrings are available of the ipsilateral, then use the hamstrings along with quadriceps. Otherwise, go for peroneus and a contralateral hamstring. Be my graft of choice. Ashish, sir, any other graft choices?
Yeah, I think you have patellar tendon bone, which if there is no scarring, you can use. Contralateral knee, you can use including bone, patellar tendon bone, even peroneus. So you have choices. I mean, it depends on the scarring if you can harvest grafts there. And you have options for doing single stage. Saurabh?
Mukesh Kandia.
Stop
here. Where has he gone?
Some issues of internet.
But then in the lighter vein, our shoulder
am I audible?
A little let down. Ki after electric shock, shoulder dislocated.
Are you there?
Ish, are you back?
Am I audible? Yes, boss. Yes. Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible, but the interruption is significant, sir. The first half was absolutely...
My screen is... Hitesh, you can just carry on. We can't see your video, but you can just keep saying.
Yes. What I did, As Ashish sir pointed out, we can have a two-stage surgery also. And the mistake I did a single-stage reconstruction, but I did a for ACL, I took a opposite hamstring graft. For PCL, and for MC, I did the same side semi-T and prepare it with the modified Bosworth technique. So this was the graft harvested, peroneus longus, opposite hamstring, and the same side semi-T analysis was used for the MCL and with the modified Bosworth technique. And I don't have an immediate post-op x-ray. This was the x-ray done after 4-5 months. That time, if anyone want to comment on this x-ray.
So we can't see your image. We can't see your screen, Hitesh.
Hitesh, have you shared the screen?
Okay. Yes, I'm sharing, boss. I don't know what's going wrong.
So just open your PPT.
Yes, is it there?
Okay, yeah. Now we can see. Yeah.
Yes, this is the post-op x-ray, 4 month post-op.
Okay. So can we see? Hello, Hitesh. Can you hear me, Hitesh?
Yes. 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 Yes.
Okay. So. Hello, Hitesh.
Yes, boss. Yes.
Okay. So this is your post-operative X-ray. Can we see some bony spur here on the medial side? Is there?
Yes. This is a four-month post-op X-ray. Yes, boss. This is the 4 month post-op X-ray, and I think this is a calcification of MCL.
Calcification.
Or anything else, I don't know. So it could be the calcification of MCL. I don't know. That is what I want.
This is heterotrophic ossification. This is heterotrophic ossification.
Okay, and
what it's very common range in multi-ligament injury.
What is the range now, Hitesh?
After the first of, I would like to point out a few complications that I encountered during the surgery. As I told you, it was the porotic bone. So when I flipped the PCL button, I was pulling at the tibial side, endo button was coming in.
Okay.
Because it breached the cortex. So I had to use one disc along with the endo button on the femoral side for the PCL.
Right.
You can see in the X-ray, one disc is visible.
Uh-huh.
And one more thing, after
ACL.
Few months, the patient for PCL.
For PCL, right.
For PCL, femoral side, endo button. When I pulled it was pulling in the tunnel. So I pulled it back and I opened from femoral side and just put an endo button along with this.
Right.
On this with the button. And second thing, this patient had a infection at the screw side, at the post side. So I had to remove the post also because this was the post-bone patient and there was a skin condition was not good. So we can choose for a two-stage surgery in this patient. Okay. And one thing. And at the last the patient is good. This is the range of movement, 18 months post-op. And stability. And the patient is doing well.
Okay. Sumit, you want to ask something?
I just wanted to ask him about the final range of motion actually. And
okay. Sir, Sachin, sir. My question, when you go for a multi-ligament injury,
yes,
and there is a MCL,
yes,
so what graft do you prefer when you have to repair MCL also? Because see, hamstrings also gives a little bit of medial stability also. So taking a hamstrings just is add to instability, or you take hamstrings also?
So I gather your question, Saurabh, is that will harvest or use of the ipsilateral hamstring tendon or an MCL reconstruction cause any problems post-operatively?
Yeah.
Is that no? The answer is no. And the current data that we have, and which is got published in AGSM, does suggest that the so-called secondary valgus stabilizer function of your hamstrings tendon is not so the case. The hamstring tendons are more of internal rotators of the tibia and not so much the so-called secondary dynamic valgus stabilizers of the knee. When you have an MCL laxity, the use of a same-sided semitendinosus to do a MCL reconstruction is absolutely justified and will not lead to any subsequent instability or disability or weakening of the medial side.
Sachin, how frequently you internal brace your MCL repairs or reconstructs?
Right. So internal brace is a totally different concept. The concept can be applied for two scenarios. Internal bracing is most commonly indicated or is advocated when you're doing a primary repair. So if one is doing a primary repair of a mid-substance tear, then it is always better to augment. The augmentation or the supplementation can be done with the help of an autograft. So you can harvest the same side hamstring tendon and you can do an MCL reconstruction at the same time. You not the whole double strand type of reconstruction, but just doing a Danish type of a reconstruction where you create one vertical limb and one oblique limb. The same thing can be done on the lateral side as well. So when you're doing a primary lateral repair, you tend to augment your repair with the help of autograft. An internal brace can be used in the same scenario. And when you're using an internal brace, the only disadvantage is that it is not an anatomical structure. So you're using a very stiff construct across a short length. You cannot use it at the normal prescribed anatomic landmarks. And hence you use it over a short length. So an internal brace has been shown. Unfortunately, we don't have any evidence or any data on a side-to-side comparison of using an internal brace for MCL vis-a-vis using an augmentation technique with an hamstring graft for the MCL. And that is what needs to be sort of looked into and published. But this is what you need to understand and make an active choice.
So have you been using fiber tapes very frequently now?
So fiber tapes around the knee joint for an extra articular, very occasionally. My go-to preference would be to use natural autograft, because we need to understand that a tape is stiff. It will not tend to have that physiologic laxity, so as to say, whereas an autograft will give you that physiologic laxity. A tape tends to sort of make it very stiff. It will not elongate with the changing knee flexion angles, and a tape will remain stiff, and at times it tends to capture the knee, and that is very important. So if I can sort of draw your attention to the case that I had presented initially where we did a primary repair, one of the main reasons why the gentleman's knee was captured and I was not able to get full flexion because I had done an internal brace which had captured his knee to about 70 degrees of flexion. So along with the arthroscopy, I also did a release of that internal brace, and that is when I could get back easy flexion of the knee joint. So internal braces are good concepts to help you save graft, but you need to use them really cautiously and carefully, and you have to be very careful of them. I think it would be wrong because it appears to be a very easy, quick fix solution. Put a couple of tapes all over the place and no graft is required. But I think we should slightly go away from that concept. They're useful adjuncts, but use them with care and caution. They cannot replace a properly done repair or a reconstruction.
Yeah, that's what I was asking.
Presentation. What is usually your sequence of repair? Like it's first PCL, then ACL, then MCL, or MCL, then PCL, then ACL. Like, is there any sequence or do you follow? Or
in the repair or reconstruction, Saurabh?
In a reconstruction.
So it actually depends upon the injury pattern. So let us consider that all four ligaments are torn and you need to do a four ligament reconstruction. So if it is feasible, then I would like to do all four in the same sitting. I would not really want to do them staged out because that adds to the burden of the patient. You lose valuable time within the rehab. So if possible, I'd like to do all four in the same sitting. The way I would do it is that I would first make the open exposures medially and laterally without a tourniquet. I would drill all the tunnels and leave them in place. I would have all the grafts harvested. Here is one place where allograft would be a very useful adjunct. And then I would go ahead, trace the tourniquet and go to all the intra-articular work. When we do the intra-articular work, I would like to drill all the tunnels according to the grafts that I've sized. And then when we start fixing them, I would fix PCL femur, ACL femur first. I would then have the knee reduced, tension and cycle the knee, fix the PCL tibia, ACL tibia. And then I would go to both the corners. I'll fix the lateral side first and then come to the medial side. If lateral side opening is way too far than the medial side, or if the medial side opening is way too far than the lateral side, I would fix the medial side first and come to the lateral side. This is completely debatable because each one has their own ways of tackling these issues. Some people like to fix the PCL and the lateral side first and then come to the medial and the ACL. But somehow I like to get that central strut in place. And I always find it better to fix the ACL tibia and the PCL tibia in the same go, because then you can really have the knee reduced, the tibia and the femur reduced underneath each other properly. If you tend to fix the PCL first, then one error that you may make is that while you're fixing the PCL, you apply an anterior drawer and then you fix the knee in anterior translation and then your ACL becomes slack. So these are problems that will be debated. Unfortunately, we cannot have randomized trials, or we cannot do sort of case controlled cohort studies. But whatever lab data we have now from various robotic sectioning studies, this is probably what is the standard of care, that you get your knee tibia under reduced underneath the femur and then start sequentially tensioning them.
Good. So now, should we move towards the lateral instability? Rajiv?
Yeah.
How's the weather there? Kolkata,
it's very it's raining like anything. The storm has started. Let's see my PowerPoint. I think should work the video.
Okay, so now we'll be dealing with multi ligament with lateral instability.
So thank you, Rosa, for this wonderful webinar and wonderful talk by Sachin sir and Rajeshwaran sir. So there are two scenarios here. The first one is a patient, a 35-year army soldier. When I was posted in Siliguri, he came in our clinic with pain and history of giving pain left knee for 6 months. And he has a transtibial ACL reconstruction 1 year back. I think I am audible, Saudav?
Yes.
Yeah. So on examination, the Lachman was positive, dial test was positive, and you can see the classical. The Lachman was positive and he had a positive dial test also. The external rotation of the tibia, you can see almost 60 to 70 degree of external rotation of the tibia at 90. So it's 60 degree of external rotation, it was dial test was positive. So what is good is, in such type of scenario, is like blessing in disguise, I tell you. If it's a transtibial tunnel, most of the time you have your anatomical ACL reconstruction site is virgin, so you don't have to plan too much. But if it's an anatomical ACL reconstruction, then yes, really it's a difficult task, you have to plan accordingly. So I think here I should stop, and my question is to, I think, Sachin sir. So dialed ACL with posterolateral corner injury, dial test positive, and ACL was reconstructed transtibially. So how will you take this patient? How will you plan?
Okay, so what we have here is a active person without osteoarthritis who has a failed ACL with a transtibial ACL reconstruction with the positive dial test. The dial test component, which is abnormal rotational stability, is coming from two sources. It is coming from the lax and incompetent posterolateral structures, as what you have suggested. Plus, it is also coming from the ACL transtibial technique, which thereby renders the knee rotationally unstable as well. The way to go about treating this person will be as follows. In evaluation, I would check his coronal plane alignment by doing a standing scanogram X-ray. If there is the coronal plane alignment is good, then he does not require any bony correction. if on the coronal plane he has got a varus deformity, then naturally this opens the door for doing a bony surgery first to correct his coronal plane alignment, and then ligaments come second. That is point number one. I would also do a single leg standing monopedal stance lateral view of the entire lower limb, and I would also want to check his tibial slope and would want to see why, if there is an excessive tibial slope, then that may need to be tackled as well, especially in the given current scenario that he has had a failed ACL reconstruction. Coming to clinical assessment, which is step number two, he would probably have a grade 3 Lochmann test. He would have a pivot shift as well. And for the lateral side clinical examination, we need to look at two things. We need to see what is the degree of opening of the lateral joint line, and what is the degree of abnormal rotation, which is the dial test that you have discussed. There are three structures which are important on the lateral side. You have the lateral collateral ligament, which is going to be the primary restraint to a varus force, number one. You have the popliteus, which is the primary restraint to external rotation at high flexion angles. And you have the popliteofibular ligament, which is the major external rotation restraint at low flexion angles. So depending upon what grade of opening that I have, if there is grade 3 opening on the lateral side at 0, 30 and 90 degrees of flexion, and there is grade 3 dial test, both at 0, 30 and 90 degrees of knee flexion, it means that all the three structures are involved. And for the lateral side, I know that he will require a double-stranded or a Lapra type of a posterolateral corner reconstruction. On the contrary, if there is rotational instability or a dial test opening, which is present at 0 and 30, but at 90 degrees, there is not a huge dial test that you can see. That means that probably the popliteus is not that severely affected. And in those patients, I'd be happy to do a modified Larsen procedure. So this is how I will approach this particular individual with respect to the procedure that I need to do, whether bone or only ligament alone. That is the first clinical deciding factor. Second is estimation of the deformity and deciding upon what procedure I need to do on the lateral side. Third is coming to the ACL per se and looking at the tunnels, that femoral tunnel and the tibial tunnel, seeing whether they are really off or are they in the light position or are they partially off. Based on that, one would need to make choices as to whether it becomes a one stage or a two stage procedure. And fourth, I would look at my various graft choices and then go ahead and proceed to do the proper graft harvest. So in a nutshell, Rajiv, this is what would be my approach to this particular patient of yours in four steps or four different stages.
Thank you, sir. And the patient has no coronal plane abnormality, and it was 90 degree, excessive external rotation was present at 90 degree of flexion, which was suggesting of almost grade 3 type of PLC injury. So what we did, if it's a PCL with PLC, normally we go for PCL first, but ACL with PLC, we can go for ACL first. So we did a routine ACL reconstruction, and as the tunnel, the tibial tunnel was not enlarged, and we had a normal the femoral tunnel was transtibial tunnel, so we went for an anatomical ACL reconstruction as we do in our routine procedure. But for posterolateral corner, we planned for a modified Laprade technique with a quadriceps split graft. And here I will go like this. I will not run this video. So normally we may do it in 90 degree of flexion of the knee, and a thick posterior base flap is created, and the most important part is neurolysis of the common peroneal limb. Hope the video is running.
Yes, it is.
So this is one of the important steps, so neurolysis of the common peroneal nerve. So once we have done the neurolysis of the common peroneal nerve, now we make our first window at the level of the lateral epicondyle, and this is very important. So you make your first window at the level of the lateral epicondyle and identify lateral epicondyle and cut your iliotibial bone proximally and distally. So this is our first window. So identify your lateral epicondyle, and now you make your fibular tunnel from the anteromedial to the posterolateral, and the finger is your best retractor area. So by that, which you can protect your beak pin. And don't use anything periosteum or a human ear. Use your finger, and that is the best protector because you have neurovascular structure posteriorly. So once your fibular tunnel is done, so place your loop. And I usually use three types of loop, yellow loop, blue loop, three color loop, so that there is no confusion. And now you make your tibial tunnel. Again, it is from the just that gradually work towards the posterior aspect of the tibia. And you pass your loop. Again, your finger, your index finger is your protector. And again, pass your blue loop, that's the ethibon. And now this is very important step. You can identify the, by pulling suture, the attachment of the popliteus and the HCL. So Sachin sir, here is one question. So suppose in revision scenario, whether you will go for a two socket femoral socket or single femoral socket? Just one line answer here.
Double femoral socket always.
Always, yeah. So I think Sachin sir is right. It's always double femoral socket. But sometime when we are dealing with a revision scenario, it's very difficult to manage this tunnel. You have two or three tunnels over the lateral femoral condyle. So I did a modification. I made a single femoral socket here. And single femoral socket, which is just anterior in between the insertion of the popliteus and the LCL. So you drill your femoral tunnel, it's towards, and try to make your tunnel towards the superior pole of the patella so that you are not infraarticular. So once your femoral tunnel is done, you can see this femoral loop, you can pass your femoral loop. Here already we had taken a quadriceps split graft. Because it was a single socket, we take a quadriceps split graft, and you can see you put it to in the femoral socket and fix it with a bio screw. And the graft was fixed with a bio screw. And you have two limbs of the graft now. You can see. So that should be a very secure fixation, your femoral socket. Either you are using a single socket or a double socket, try to fix it very rigidly so that because whole of the load of your construct of the posterolateral corner, the load will come over the desk. And you can see, yes, it has a good fixation there. Now you pass your loop under the iliotibial band. You can see you pass your loop under the iliotibial band. And the first graft from anterior aspect of the fibula, and then try to take both the graft to the anterior aspect of the tibia. And you put and you give and just give a gentle anterior draw at 60 degree of flexion, fix your tibial tunnel. And this is the way, this is all a bit modification of the Laprade technique where you are creating all these three ligaments, the LCL, the oblique popliteal ligament, and the popliteus. And you can see, assess the stability, the external dial test is negative, and your varices test is also negative. And this is the routine closure. So now this patient, he is he posted in Jammu. So he sent 6 months, but he sent a follow-up, 4 year follow-up. We operated in 2016 and he is doing well. So Raju sir, what is your take on this posterolateral corner injury, ACL with PLC?
Yeah, so very nicely demonstrated video, I would just like to suggest everyone to read this month's issue of arthroscopy. If you ever wanted a debate between a fibula based procedure, month's issue of arthroscopy. Two excellent cadaveric studies, one showing a good way to just do a simple fibula, the classical procedure that we've been doing for so long, and another study which compares this fibula technique with the classical Laprade technique, and the findings are that there is no good way to reconstruct the PLC. If you just do a fibular-based procedure, you are under-constraining the knee at 90 degrees. If you do this Laprade kind of procedure, you are over-constraining the knee at 60 degrees, which is the position of athletic function. So and the editorial commentaries are also very worth reading. One editorial commentary says that is better the enemy of good? I mean, is anatomic reconstruction the enemy of something which we are already doing well for such a long time? And Dr. Laprade has given an editorial commentary in which he has used very strong words. Words like we admonish people who don't do anatomic lateral sided reconstruction. So my take on this is that I would probably have done a fibular sling based procedure in this particular patient. along with an ACL reconstruction.
All right. So this is another case. In that case, the dial test was positive, so we planned for leopard. The another case, a 25 years soccer player from Mohan Bagan team. He had a pain and giving way of sensation of the left knee and history of twisting injury 6 weeks back. So on examination, the posterior door was positive, varices test was positive, but dial test was negative. So for me, these patients are good for sling procedure, fibula sling procedure, where you have dial negative and varus positive.
And Rajiv, if I may add, very recently I have started including stress x-rays in my armamentarium for managing.
Yes. Yeah.
So maybe the published measurements on the stress x-rays can guide us in the right direction.
So very good point by Raju sir. So stress x-ray, I think if you go with the article of Laprade, so now he has mentioned the routine varus and valgus stress x-ray, and the measurements are very important in decision making. It's a very good point. You can see here, so patient has a complete LCL tear and a PCL tear. Hope the video will run. So the varus test was positive, and you can see here the posterior door. So Raju, what will be your say here? So how will you plan?
So yeah, it's a posterior drawer and varus test is positive. I would probably like to do a single stage reconstruction, a PCL reconstruction and a lateral sided reconstruction, as you mentioned. My preference would not be the anatomical. I would like to do less tunnels, the fibula sling based procedure, which has worked well in my hands so far.
Ashish sir?
So I think young player, is he a sportsman? That's what you said.
Yes, soccer player.
I think the Laprade technique along with the PCL reconstruction.
Yeah, and Saurav, your take? I think Saurav network.
Okay. Yeah, no. I've just unmuted it. So yeah. Okay, definitely I'll go for a PCL reconstruction along with just a single sling, fibular sling, what we call a Larson's technique.
Yeah, so I did follow the same because only the varus stress test was positive and he had varus stress test was positive and hello, the network is working. The varus stress test was positive and he had a posterior door test was also positive. So as suggested by Sachin sir, we always centralize the knee first in such scenario. If you have a PCL injury, I think that should be taken versus centralize your knee first. So go for a PCL reconstruction first and then repairs your collateral over your centralized knee. And that was a very good message which was told by Sachin sir. So we did our routine PCL reconstruction. This was a routine PCL reconstruction with a quadriceps graft. We did our routine PCL reconstruction. And I think this was a, and this is important. And here, after that, we planned for a PLC repair with a reconstruction with a semi-T graft. And here, since dial test was negative and varus test was positive, we planned for a fibula sling procedure. So this is the position and the skin is incision is same as like we did in Laprade. Neurolysis of posterior base flap, neurolysis of the common peroneal nerve. And now, so that is important. There are two techniques, Arcerio and Larson. In Larson, you have one socket. In Arcerio, you make two sockets. So again, here I prefer Larson, a single femoral socket. So always put a tack suture over your FCL, put a tack suture over your popliteus, and just in between them, you can put you can make your femoral socket. So, and try to tilt towards the superior pole of the patella so that you have, you are not violating your joint. So once you make your femoral socket, you make your so normally I drill with 4 millimeter drill bit through and through towards the medial cortex, and then you make your socket, and now you do your fibular tunnel is from antero superior to the posterolateral and part, and pass your semi-T graft or a gracilis graft from the fibular tunnel. Now this is important. Once you pass your graft here, now make it equal, and now you pass it to the femoral tunnel. And then again at
I think we are in the middle of the storm.
Yeah.
Calcutta. So there's some interruption. So just wait for 1 minute and then.
Yeah, we'll just wait for 1 minute and if we didn't get it, then
move
for the next case. Okay, Rajiv.
Rajiv, you need to unmute.
Yeah. Yes, yeah. Rajiv.
Actually, yeah, suddenly the. Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, but you need
yeah,
to.
Yeah, it's raining like anything. And it's so strong. I think 150 kilometers. Everything is with it.
Enjoy, enjoy, Rajiv. Enjoy.
Be in front of a laptop, you're roaming like this.
So you need to share the screen again.
I think only the follow up is there, only follow up video is there. So, yeah. What is the take home message that you plan? You can plan for a fibrosing procedure or a TBL based procedure depending upon your instability on the lateral side. So if it's only a varus instability, go for a fibular sealing procedure. It works well. If it is a varus plus rotatory instability, go for a TBL-based procedure like laparotomy procedure.
Okay. Rajiv, my question is, if there is a PCL with lateral instability, when we do PCL reconstruction, sometimes we feel intra-op only that lateral instability or posterolateral corner instability has gone. In that case also, you do lateral sling or lateral reconstructions?
Yeah, same question I asked with laparotomy in Goa. So with ACL, with MCL, once you reconstruct your ACL, your grade 3 MCL is grade 2, whether you will live or not.
Yeah.
He told you whatever assessment is your preoperatively, that is your injury. So you have assessed it preoperatively, laxity is there, repair it. Don't think like after ACL reconstruction is grade 1 MCL now, it's grade 3, it's converted to grade 1, that MCL will work. It will not work. And I think after that, I am following this principle. Sachin, okay. Sir, your take on this?
I completely agree with you. I think it is incorrect to sort of, you know, reclassify your injury once you've fixed one ligament.
Yes.
Of course, there is always... the ACL and the PCL and the medial side and the lateral side, they are complementary to each other. So, you know, surgical stabilization of one structure is always going to decrease or step down the laxity by one grade for sure.
Yes.
But that does not mean that you just leave it alone thinking that everything has been sorted out there.
My question to Raju. Raju, you are operating a benign looking ACL. And once you go in, you put your scope in and you see that drive-through sign is positive. Do you go and reconstruct the lateral structures or not?
Right. So, generally, if it were my own worked up case, this probably situation will not happen. But I get where you're hitting at. Sometimes I operate for colleagues. And when you are seeing the patient first on the operating table and you have a lateral or a medial drive through positive. So again, the examination under anesthesia, if it's a symmetrical laxity, I would always examine the patient under anesthesia. If it is symmetrical, I'll probably not go ahead. If the patient has not been counseled fault, I will definitely not go ahead and reconstruct anything on the medial or on the lateral side. But if it were my own worked up patient, it would be a disastrous situation to find myself in such a predicament. And this is a tough situation to get out of.
Right. I think any other questions?
And Saurabh, maybe I just want to add one comment that all these fibular sling procedures, one essential thing to check in your clinical examination would be the intactness of the superior tibiofibular joint. If that is also injured, then these are relatively contraindicated and maybe the more aggressive laparot type or a TBL based procedures might be given consideration.
Right. So I think lateral side, our concepts are quite clear now. So Ashish sir, I think we can take on your case.
Okay, so just a minute, let me start my screen.
I until the time the screen is started, sort of in answer to your question that you asked about reclassification of instability, a philosophical answer can be found in the Katha Upanishad, which says that there are always two ways to a problem, the pleasant way and the correct way. One must always do the pleasant, the correct way.
Right.
So I'm starting screen share. Okay. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Yeah.
What a lovely photograph.
Yeah. This is Moti Dungri.
This is Moti Dungri. This was shot, I think, about 15 days ago.
I hope each of your slides has photographs like this.
Nothing. So, nothing to do at home during the lockdown. So, this is the only thing. I can see Moti Dungri from my home. So, this is all what I could do. Okay. So, we have this 35-year-old road traffic accident. Came to us 18 hours after his injury, injured his right knee. Initially was treated elsewhere. They did a close reduction and POP slab. It was a dislocation. And he came to us, emergency assessment. In the emergency, the neurovascular status was okay. The knee was unstable. We examined him, and this is what his x-rays looked like. So, opinion from the house, maybe Hitesh, you want to take this up? How would you manage this, start managing this case? Hitesh is not there.
Hitesh is here, Hitesh. I'll just unmute him. Yes, Hitesh, can you hear? Hitesh can't hear.
Okay, Rajat, you want to take up? Rajat, your opinion? So this was his injury. He was managed elsewhere. They did a close reduction and he came to us. We examined his injuries and we took him in the theater. Rajat?
Yes, sir. So this, this patient has presented with the knee dislocation, and more often, this patient may be having a neurovascular injury. So first thing is to rule out a neurovascular injury, and we have to again re-examine this patient after 48 to 72 hours for a secondary thrombosis due to intimal injury. So there might be a vascular injury, which may be after 48 to 72 hours. So first thing to do an emergency reduction of these patients, and then again reassess the patient. Or sometime we may not be able to do a close reduction in these patients due to a soft tissue entrapment that might be a buttonholing of a condyle through the soft tissue, or there might be a soft tissue entrapment inside the joint. So, first we need to, to do a neurovascular assessment and then later do a close reduction as early as possible, if permissible.
Sumit, your opinion? Sumit, you need to unmute yourself. So, Sumit, so can you see this? A small chip here.
It's a patellar tendon, sir.
So that gives you an indication that there might be a patellar tendon avulsion. We tried to do a examination under anesthesia, and this was reducible, but this patellar tendon was avulsed. So we just reduced it, got an MRI. So MRI showed ACL, PCL, LCL, MCL. All four gone. Lateral meniscus displaced, bucket handle tear, patellar tendon distally avulsed. So Sumit?
Yeah, thank you. So now I can unmute. That's the point I was trying to make, that there seems like a chip fracture down, which probably at the site of the patellar tendon avulsion. Yeah. So at this point, yes, I would like to go for the patellar tendon repair.
Mm-hmm.
Alongside, since it's very, very unstable at this acute stage, I would like to do a patellar tendon repair and a fixator probably, and come back a couple of weeks later. And at that point, I will assess the other the collaterals at that point alongside the cruciates.
If you put a fixator, how long do you plan to keep the fixator?
Two to three weeks. Yeah, just so let the massive edema and everything just settle down, and then go in and repair.
Okay. Any other anyone else from the panel?
Can we see the MR images?
Okay, so MR images. Let me see. MR images. I don't. So we just have. We don't have the MRI images. So you have ACL, PCL, LCL, MCL, complete tears, medial meniscus, lateral meniscus tears, and patellar tendon avulsed.
So what is the status of LCL and MCL, whether they are avulged or substantial?
No, just tears, not avulsed. Avulsed is only patellar tendon.
Should be reduced under GA or without GA if it is reduced. Now you have a MRI picture. You have extensor mechanism has to be restored first. So it is a severe injury. So what we can do it in a two-stage thing. First we do a extensor mechanism, and then we can, or along with this, if there is significant medial collaterals gone, we can do a collaterals also along with extensor mechanism. But then it has to be a two-stage procedure, and second stage we need to go for an intra-articular because it's a severe injury. So no need in an acute stage, you no need to go for a complete repair thing. But yes, extensor mechanism is important.
Yeah, Dr. Rajiv, your opinion. Dr. Rajiv?
Yeah. So always in such type of injury, if you have associated patellar tendon avulsion, so I'll go for my PCL and patellar tendon avulsion in one stage, and then the collaterals usually in second stage. Say.
So anyone else, if anyone else wants to comment? Raju? Okay, so let's go for. So this is what we did. This was stable on reducing. Sorry, not stable on reducing. This was an unstable kind of dislocation. We did a patellar tendon avulsion repair by intraosseous sutures, and we also did this loop, the loop of PBW loop. To support the patellar tendon. And we also put a fixator because this was an unstable type of a dislocation. We did not do the collaterals or the ACL, PCL because, so this is what it was. He had a fracture of the tibia. And he had other associated injuries. So that is why we did not want to spend too much time on one thing. So other things also had to be managed. So this fixator was had to be retained for a little long time. We kept the fixator for 6 weeks because the other things were also need to be managed. And we removed the fixator after 6 weeks. We don't have the post-op because this patient went for did not come back because of this lockdown. But he started rehabilitating, and his collaterals are stable. We saw him once. His collaterals are stable, and he is able to stand without brace. So any comments?
Range of motion, Dr. Ashish.
So range of motion is we did a MUA once. So we could get 120 degrees just after removing the fixator.
We did not
remove the wire loop, but did a manipulation, 120 degrees range on table, and he is still doing physio, but his collaterals are stable.
And
The only difference I would have done probably is not to use the wire loop, since you have not removed it and it's an uncertain time when you actually might get to remove it. I would probably use the tape. This is the only instance where I would like to augment it with the tape.
Yeah, yeah. So
otherwise, I would agree with the trauma management. Of course, we'll be guided by the trauma colleagues as well.
So unfortunately, that was the only thing, because we don't have it available in OT. So we use this wire.
So, Dr. Ashish sir.
Yeah.
Do you augment with a semi-T?
So we didn't need to augment, because
the wire loop that you put in, instead of that, would you like to put in a semi-T loop?
No, not for evulsions, because the evulsion was quite stable, quite good fixation.
Quite good fixation. Okay. All right.
So if had it been the patellar tendon, the mid substance or something, we would have done an augment with a semi-T. Sachin, your opinion?
So I think, Ashish, this is a completely challenging case, and the treatment plan, as you've rightly discussed here, is that reduce the knee, neurovascular stability, manage all the other life-threatening injuries, and till such time, as regards the knee per se, I think a lot would be dependent upon the degree of instability and whether you have any fixable avulsions or not. In your case, since most of the both the cruciates and the collaterals were mid-substance tears and which were not amenable to a primary fixation except for the patellar tendon avulsion, you've gone ahead by doing the right thing by fixing the patellar avulsion, which has to be done on an ASAP basis, and protecting it with a cerclage loop and spanning the knee with an X-fix, while the other more severe limb injuries were also taken care of. So I would have done probably the same thing. My only concern would have been that I probably would not have put in the first chance pin that you have in the proximal tibia there, essentially because that is probably where you'll be doing the tunnels and you're not wanting to have any sort of previous violation of that area for fear of any secondary infection or something of that sort. But of course, that is a completely intraoperative decision, because being the primary surgeon there, you know what the stability looks like when you put in your X-fix. And you cannot do a half-hearted job just because you're afraid of something happening later on.
So
in roughly around 3 to 4 weeks, take out that cerclage loop, put him onto a PCL type of brace, get him moving. And once he gets his decent movement back and gets decent strength back, at least 80% that of the opposite side, then go ahead and do a four ligament reconstruction or whatever it is based on the assessment of the scenario then.
Exactly. Yeah. So this pin, the reason for this pin was...
excellent case, doctor.
So there was a fracture there. So we just wanted to bridge that fracture.
Yeah, yeah.
Completely agree with you.
So
any one, Rajiv, there is one question for you. The question is from Dipesh Kumar Patel. Your case is finished, na, Ashish sir?
Yeah, yeah, we finished this case. We can take the next whenever you want.
Excellent case to show damage control orthopedics. I think Ashish sir. Yeah. See, so we say it's not always issued with such type of fracture scenario. Yeah, sorry. What is the question?
One question from Dr. Dipesh Patel for you. Sir, do all components, LCL, popliteus, and PFL, need to be addressed in all PCL with grade 3 PLC injuries?
No, as we were discussing with Sachin sir also, when it is grade 3 only, yeah, you have to address all the three components. Yeah.
Only in grade 3, otherwise?
Yeah.
Sachin sir, what is your take on this?
The question being is that do all three components of the posterolateral corner need to be addressed? Am I right, Saurabh?
Every time.
So it all depends upon the degree of instability that you have.
Right.
And again, you have to look at two components on the posterolateral side. You have to look at varus opening. You have to look at rotation. You have to look at opening and varus opening and rotation at low flexion angles and high flexion angles. And based on the same, then you decide. If there is only varus opening without any rotation at all, then you can do an isolated LCL reconstruction. If there is varus opening with external rotation opening at low flexion angles, not at high flexion angles and of low grade, you can do a modified Larsen. But if there is a high degree, then I think you have to do the whole lot per se.
Yeah, right.
I think message conveyed. Yeah.
Yeah.
Ashish sir, we can take on your next
question. Okay. So... This was a 54-year-old male, road traffic accident in December. He had a fracture of the medial tibial condyle with ACL and PCL avulsion, MCL tear, and a posterolateral coronary injury. So these findings were confirmed in MRI also. So this was what the dislocation looked like. So any comments from anyone? How would you start handling this case?
So we need to start with the neurovascular thing only in such kind of dislocation.
So yeah, so let's rule out neurovascular. Neurovascular is normal, we confirmed. So rotation kind of injury, dislocation.
Yeah, next we need to try to reduce it under GA.
Yeah.
Immediately, so that any tension on neurovascular bundle should go. If you are able to reduce it, then we need to plan what to do next. But if we are not able to reduce it, then immediate open reduction has to be done.
Yeah. So I think you're right. We first need to assess, take him in the theater under anesthesia, examine his knee, try to reduce it. Basics and see if it is reducible. If it is reducible, that takes a lot of tension out. If it is not reducible, we have to make sure that we do something to reduce it. Now, he has an ACL and PCL avulsion and a rotation. So that's his MRI. So it needs to be fixed first. We can understand. He has a MCL tear. MCL tear from the femoral side.
Right.
ACL, PCL avulsion and posterolateral coronary injury.
So Dr. Rajesh, did he also have skin dimpling from the MRI images? It looks as if there is invagination of the medial tissues.
Yes.
So I don't remember because I didn't see him myself, but I guess there might be.
Because with this extent of subluxation, a buttonholing must always be kept in mind.
Correct.
The
correct.
Failure
absolutely.
To reduce closed must
absolutely.
Be
yeah, absolutely
factored
right.
in the management.
Yeah.
So were you able to reduce it under GA or no?
So we were not able to reduce it even under GA. So we decided for doing an open reduction,
right.
Fixing the condyle, see if we can reduce it. Anything else from anyone?
Rajiv?
Yes, the first thing is that you should reduce it. And if under anesthesia is reducible, I think is primary management is trauma management. So we are less concerned about in such type of scenario of a soft tissue.
So I did not see him. My clinical assistant, he saw him and could not reduce. So we took up in the OT. So in OR also under anesthesia, this was not reducible.
That suggests invagination of capsule here.
Correct.
So in such cases, my trauma colleague would always want a CT scan as well to better understand the personality of osseous injuries. In addition,
yeah. So we had already put him under anesthesia. So.
So the question is whether we should take the patient directly to the OT or we should take wait to take CT scans and all.
So that's what we can't delay too much. So we once we rule out neurovascular, so the next point is get an MRI and then don't waste too much time. Take him to the theater. You also have to look for late night hours and can't delay him for the next day. So we took him in the OT under anesthesia, tried to reduce it. It was not reducing. So we opened up. Anything else?
No.
I think essentially now it's more of a trauma case and fixing the bones first and then coming back for the ligaments.
If required.
Yeah. Depending.
So that's what we did. Fix the medial condyle from medial side. Avulsions, ACL and PCL fixed. PCL, we could not fix that posterior fragment. We could not fix that posterior fragment because we opened from the anterior side. The MCL was evulsed from the femoral side, so we use that spike washer. The PCL, we took sutures from PCL and passed it out from the, you can see that button sitting out. So we fixed that substance of PCL.
Yeah, endo button.
Yeah.
Endo button.
Endo button. And that screw is fixing the ACL avulsion. And we also put a fixator because this was unstable. So opinion from the house?
I would have probably put in a plate, but apart from that, everything else would pretty much be the same.
So yeah, we thought about that, but then we had already decided of putting a fixator.
So yeah.
Yeah. So that's what we did. So Rajiv?
So how did you expose it, Dr. Ashish? Your exposure was?
Yeah, just like we do an extended for the knee, total knee. Same
medial parapetalar
approach. Yeah.
So stitches look like more towards the medial side.
Yeah, sorry. So it was little on the medial side.
Medial side, yeah.
So tilting towards the medial side because we had to fix the things from the medial side mainly.
Medial screws and all.
Yeah.
MCL also repaired. Right?
Yeah.
So, okay. So this second X-ray, that's looking united in second X-ray. Right.
Raju, your comments?
Yeah, it looks like a well-done job. The only area of concern looks posteriorly where I think a little bit of bony protuberance is seen. Do you have a follow-up to share? I mean, I noticed this in December.
So, we never saw this patient after this.
No news is either.
He was probably not happy with our surgery.
No, but not even for a X-fix removal, nothing.
Nothing. He never came back. So anyone else from among the house must have seen this.
Sorrow.
No,
you're not removed.
Even if I would have seen now, I would have called you immediately.
I mean, I think, just for discussion that this is what we need to do, probably.
Yeah.
So well done. I would have probably placed the incision a little bit more posteriorly, which allows easier access to the, I mean, again, it's a situation specific thing. It's very easy to be very wise in retrospective wisdom. But then my approach may have been a little bit posterior. So that PCL avulsion, because I have done a combined ACL, PCL, bony avulsion fixation. These are not easy surgeries.
Yeah.
To combine them with such kind of proximal tibial injuries.
I think we have covered almost complete spectrum of multi-ligament. But one thing which is lacking in this thing is ALL. Sachin sir, do you have anything for ALL? Because you are doing good number of ALLs. And
so anterolateral ligament essentially is a part of the anterolateral ligament complex. There are two theories as to what constitutes the anterolateral ligament complex. The first is the ALL theory, which has been proposed and propagated by the French and the Belgium group, in which they believe that the ALL is a distinct structure and it runs on the lateral side, on the tibial side, it inserts somewhere in between the Gerdes tubercle and the fibular neck on the tibia. And on the femoral side, the proposed insertion site is somewhere posterior and proximal to the popliteus. The other group, which believes that the structures that give rise to anterolateral stability are nothing but the Kaplan fibers of the iliotibial band. So the iliotibial band, which is present, will have two components. You have the iliotibial and the iliopatellar. The iliotibial has got two components. You have the superficial ITB, which we frequently incise when you do a lateral approach to the femur. And you have the deep ITB, which has got fibers which blend with the lateral intermuscular septum. About close to 8 to 9 centimeters proximal to the joint, you will find that there are thick bands of the deep ITB, which will coalesce with the deep lateral intramuscular septum. And these form what are called as the Kaplan fibers. So whenever there is disruption of the anterolateral ligament complex, either the so-called ALL or the Kaplan fibers, you get abnormal rotational stability, which has to be recognized clinically by doing a pivot shift type of test. And then this has to be restored in the treatment modality that you feel appropriate to what you're inclined. You could either do an ALL reconstruction with the help of a free soft tissue graft, or you could reconstruct the Kaplan fibers by using a strip of the ileotibial band, which can be based distally as in a modified Lemaire procedure, or which can be based proximally in what is called as a modified Ellison procedure.
Right. Then we don't have time for third case, Rahul. Should we wind up?
I think yes.
It's already 8 o'clock.
8 o'clock. Yeah.
Yeah. Or excellent spectrum of cases.
Yeah.
So Rahul, over to you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Sachin. Thank you, Raju. Thank you, Rajiv. Thank you all.
Thank you so very much.
Thank you. Okay.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank
Goyal,
you.
Sir. Goyal, sir, would you like to give a word of thanks?
Yeah. Good evening, friends. We are really lucky to have you all. I must thank Dr. Sachin. He has very clearly sent the messages to all the viewers and audience that what should be done and what should not be done. This was a plethora of very good cases, and simultaneously Dr. Raju and Dr. Rajiv Raman, they all are very good, and especially our Saurav Mathur, Ashish, and many more panelists. I must thank all of them from Rajasthan Orthopedic Surgeons Association. Thank you very much for participating, and thank you very much for enlightening us on these cases. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Rajesh.
Thank you.
So, thank you, friends. Thank you, everyone. So, on behalf of Rajasthan Orthopedic Surgeons Association, I would like to thank all the participants, our guest faculty, Sachin, Rajiv, and Raju, all our state faculty. Also, thanks to Ortho TV team, Dr. Ashok Shyam, for live streaming of this webinar. Also, thankful to our sponsor, Cadila Pharma, to providing us the platform. So thank you. Goodbye. Stay safe. Now I'm ending this meeting. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.